There was a time when Germans raised the Stichelhaar, with which the Drachthaar could be confused, but this ancient breed has now been abandoned, even by the rare enthusiasts. The massive dog, which reached 66 centimeters at the withers, was tainted by continuous breeding with the local dogs. It was abandoned in favor of the Drachthaar, which is smaller and more agile, and with a fondness for work that immediately took the top position, and today it is still the only rough-haired German pointer to conquer the hearts of the hunters all over Europe. Therefore, while the Stichelhaar has been nearly entirely forgotten, the more modern Drachthaar is well represented on the hunting scene and in trials. It is a valued breed in eastern countries, where excellent dogs are found, clever on the ground and on all the game, furred or feathered. The origins of this dog are quite recent. It seems that the first breeding program began in 1906. In previous years, breeders had included all the rough-coated dogs, even if they did not breed true types, and had very different characteristics. Once the breeders managed to breed dogs that were uniform and true to type, the breed was recognized and accepted. It seems that the Drachthaar is the product of a mixture of several entirely different breeds. The Stichelhaar, the Pudel, the Pointer, the Airedale, the Kurzhaar and the Corth or Griffon, with the tendency to have a rough coat, almost like steel wool. In fact, the name of the breed derives from the word dracht, wire, and haar, hair. It inherited a firm point, now entirely acquired, from the Pointer, the Kurzhaar and the Corthul. A passion for water from the Pudel and the sought-after rough coat from the Airedale. It seems that even the Pudelpointer played a part in the creation of the Drachthaar. This breed, the result of crossing a poodle and a pointer, had by now been abandoned. The development of the breed was the work of a group of breeders led by Hegewald, who controlled the breeding program that finally created the Drachthaar. Until some time ago, it was said that the relatively new breed gave rise to heterogeneous subjects, where puppies could be born with short hair like the Kurzhaar, and others furnished with an excellent coat with the bushy hair on the face and on the eyebrows. But now, although some dogs with rough short hair are occasionally bred, the standard has been stabilized by enthusiastic breeders who strove to respect the original characteristics required by Hegewald. Hegewald was born in Neukirch in 1838 and died in Halle in 1903. An old photograph shows him with one of the first Drachthaars lying at his feet. The characteristics of the breed are already evident. Unfortunately, breeding was halted during the two world wars, in particular the Second World War, severely affected breeding programs in Germany and above all that of the Drachthaar. There was still a lot of work to be done in order to complete the program, but German breeders are determined and tenacious, and starting above all with brown solid color dogs, they developed the standard that we can admire today. Medium-sized hunting dog with a striking appearance. It has a wiry coat that resists cold, damp and injury. The breed has got a lively temperament and an energetic personality. At times it may seem aggressive, but never with its owner, with whom it is particularly docile and faithful. The height at the withers is 58 to 62 centimeters in the dogs and 56 to 60 centimeters in the bitches. The trunk is well balanced, as tall as it is long. Head. The skull planes of the upper muzzle converge, the face is well balanced, the skull is of a normal length, the stop slightly pronounced, the lower profile of the muzzle is formed by the mandible and therefore the lips appear very moderate. The flat triangular ears are set high, the tips turned in but never fringed. The eyes are in a semi-lateral position and must be dark and almond-shaped. The teeth must be strong and complete, suitable for a dog adapted to hard work. The neck must be equal in length to the head, without any ridges, and the nose must be prominent. Body: shoulders sloping and muscular, brisket wide and deep, ribs well sprung, back short, firm and level, loins well muscled, croup long and wide and slightly sloping, bones solid, strong, good tuck up, forelegs straight and lean, elbows tight, thighs strong and muscular, stifles well bent and hocks well let down, round or cat feet, no dew claws, hard resistant pads. Dog tail, generally one-third its natural length, but preferably slightly longer rather than slightly shorter. Coat. The quality of the coat is of great importance to the breed because it must always be wiry, of medium length, with a dense undercoat in winter. The colour should be drab, liver, and white or black and white, recalling barbed wire. It must not hide the contours of the body, but must provide a good protection against bad weather and injury. On the head, it must have bushy eyebrows, a beard, and very thick whiskers, but not too long. Principal faults. The following faults disqualify, as in all breeds: cryptorchidia, monorchidia, deafness and glassy eye, biting due to a mental disturbance or congenital fear. Very serious faults: heavy build, timidness, a lightness that denotes little substance, facial skull planes not correct, stop not clearly pronounced, dental deviations, prognatism and enognatism, not restricted to the breed, no premolars, small eyes, rapacious yellow eyes, narrow rib cage, ridges, coat too fine or too long, soft or woolly, skin too thick, descending rump, feet with open toes, closed or open hocks, the shin bone too long, back like a barrel, big tail carried high, a light coloured nose or toenails. These are considered less serious faults: clear eyes not yellow, soft beard, thin eyebrows, opaque or damaged coat, fleshy neck, low withers or a short rump, closed or wide-set elbows, too short or too long a tail, wide feet, a fluffy tail. The Drachthaar that does not have very evident faults must be correctly proportioned in the body, musculature and joints, in such a way that the dog can move fluidly with speed and resistance. Anyone who intends to purchase a puppy as a future help on hunting trips needs to know the various national breeders and the dog's pedigree, how successful the bloodline has been in shows and in trials, and what champions have been produced from the dogs and bitches. Then it is possible to make personal contact with the kennels and take the important decision of which dog to choose. As there are no particular genetic problems with this breed, it is sufficient to look for the more active puppies, the ones that do not show signs of illness, and those who throw themselves voraciously onto their food. A strong appetite is always a sign of good health. The Drachthaar should be chosen as a puppy, exploiting its own particular endearing characteristic. It will bond with one person, subsequently refusing situations that are new or unfamiliar. Its love for its master is often disproportionate, and its training can only be completed when it has totally accepted its owner. The puppy must be kept outside, in a pen or in a fenced garden. It is a rather hardy, rustic breed and will suffer in a house with central heating. It prefers the crisp cold of the winter to the torrid heat of the summer. It is, however, necessary to position the pen where it is sheltered from prevailing winds and damp, although when the dog is let free in the countryside, it is not afraid of plunging into water, whatever the season. Between 2 and 5 months of age, the Drachthaar's training must be entirely aimed at obedience, which must become a second nature. Choose the name you intend to call it by, without adding any other words, and reward it every time it rushes to you. Once it has learned the recall, begin teaching down, the classic crouch position with head between the front legs. Encourage obedience with any juicy tidbit, but only allow the dog to take it on command. The retrieve is also part of courtyard training. Begin by throwing a small cloth ball in front of the dog. Instinctively, it will run after the ball and pick it up. At this stage, you should call it and expect it to come towards you to deliver it. The old school suggests the usual reward of a tidbit after the delivery, but it is necessary to interrupt this system early on, because in the long run, there is the danger that the dog will drop the retrieve in order to get the reward. Continue with the training, passing from the little ball to another slightly larger object, such as a straw-filled rabbit skin, perhaps decorated with a pigeon wing. Only when the young Drachtar performs this exercise well can you move on to dead game, which is nearly always domestic quail at first. If the dog shows hard bite, you can use frozen quail or wind some resistant material round the bird. From quail, it can move on to pigeon and then pheasant. Many experts are well aware of its innate problems with large retrieves, and they do not use anything larger than pigeon in order to avoid encouraging the instinctive hard bite in young dogs. After the age of 5 months, the young pupil can be taken to the countryside to practice in open spaces the obedience already acquired in the courtyard. Being a quite precocious breed, it may be started at 7 months with game. Always keep it under control, letting it free in a field with some domestic quail. Bring it onto the quarry with the wind in its face until it can pick up the scent. Lead it towards the quail to see if it has inherited the instinct of hunting with brief stops, and observe the dog's expression and the rigidity. The point is always instinctively present in a Drachtar of good quality, and after a few encounters it will remain static just to get the scent of the game. However, when the game is flushed, the dog will tend to pursue the game frantically. It is important to teach it to behave correctly, that is, to remain immobile, allowing the hunter to take aim without distractions of any kind. This stage is not easy, but if the puppy is intelligent, after a number of lessons, it will keep still after flushing the game. It is much more difficult to stop it rushing after a hare or make it leave larger game, such as deer, alone. It is naturally very attracted by big game, which it pursues with inherent determination from the start, and at times you may risk losing the dog in pursuit of roe or fallow deer. Energetic punishment does not always get the right result, only constant steadiness, above all if the subject is compliant and intelligent, will work at this particular point of the training. Around 1 year of age, it is necessary to start training the young dog seriously on proper game, adapted to its natural talent. You can use grey partridges or pheasants, it does not matter, as long as it is real and wild, so that the dog can improve with practice. Since the Drachtar likes hunting on covered ground, in woods and swamps, it is necessary to avoid the wide open moors, which are more adapted to the English breeds, although it performs in an acceptable way in this habitat. In real hunting, the dog must behave in the same correct and obedient way achieved during training with the surrogate game. Quartering the ground according to the wind, standing still at the flush and the shot, retrieving all types of large size game without biting it. Above all, when pointing, there must not be any errors, but the pose must be held for a long time and the drive is performed calmly, but at the same time securely, tagging after the game if it tries to run away. As the Drachtar is a continental breed, it is accustomed to working alone and not always inclined to accept the consent of another pointer. This skill will require special training. Bring together two gun dogs, and while one is immobile, insist that it respects the work of the other until the end. At first, keep it on the leash, patting it to calm it, letting it observe the whole scene up to the flight of the game. There are also systems of intimidation, but with calm and perseverance, everything can be achieved. Some have defined the Drachtar, above all from a physical point of view, as a Kurzhaar with short hair. Even in work, it partly repeats the characteristics of the Kurzhaar, but at times less dramatically when pointing, bringing the head just over the horizontal. In the original concept, common to nearly all the continental pointing dogs, the gait must alternate moments of trotting with moments of fast, but not excessively excited galloping. The standard specifies that the gallop is an energetic but not impetuous gait, and while the back thrusts with harmonic vigor, the front is rampant without excessive surges, giving a collected and continuous pace. At the gallop, the tail prolongs the top line or is slightly below but never above it. Today, modern hunters expect good speed from the Drachtar when the ground is open and free of vegetation. The gallop is rather reserved, but not always slower than the Kurzhaar, as is commonly thought. The dog prefers wide open spaces, but in vegetation, woods or swamps, it adapts its technique to the nature and difficulty of the habitat, abandoning the gallop for an energetic but profitable trot. The Drachtar is particularly good at working in brambles and thickets. It can get into the most difficult places to tenaciously rouse hidden game from places where many other dogs would hesitate to go, where they cannot overcome natural difficulties. In swamps, in summer or winter, it is always master of the situation, since it is an excellent swimmer and often an excellent water retriever. It seems to be an ideal dog for collecting fallen ducks from deep water of any temperature. It has an innate sense of the retrieve in all conditions, preferring bigger game, grey partridge, duck, hare, pheasant, and it locates the wounded game even at a distance, joyfully bringing it to its master. It is not the preferred breed for hunting woodcock because the colour of its coat is not very visible in the woods. However, the enthusiasts who trust the Drachtar to seek the woodcock, the so-called queen of the wood, say they are keen workers in this particular habitat. The point. The essential characteristic of the form, as in the Kurzhaar, is a straight line, longer or shorter, relative to the distance from where the scent comes. The Drachtar quarters go from the gallop to the trot and then to the walk, lowering its body and craning its neck, often with a rather feline bending of the legs. The stop is never down or very low. The dog remains on its feet, and the above characteristics are slightly less emphasized than in the Kurzhaar. Only when it suddenly finds itself on top of the game for any reason does it stop with the vexed expression of someone who finds themselves in an unexpected situation. Drive. After the point, if the game holds its distance, the dog performs the drive with its limbs, flexed, helping itself in a particularly difficult moment, in brief, detailed phases. The better dogs, however, nose to the wind on the scent, make towards the scent of the animal without lowering the nose. Many enthusiasts of the breed tolerate brief pauses in the hunt, but the standard of all the pointing dogs unanimously condemn these moments. It is always considered a fault, and therefore even the Drachtar must refrain from halting. In the drive, it stops at every movement of the game until it points, waits for the flush, and then it can begin its favorite activity, the retrieve. We have already said that this talent is instinctively well developed in this breed and common to all the continental dogs performing it, in spite of difficulties of the terrain. It is very unlikely for the Drachtar to lose even one quarry, above all if it is wounded or falls at a distance. Pheasants, which now are the most common game, notoriously confide in their solid legs for their salvation, have no escape with the Drachtar. Following its action, our helper always returns triumphantly with the vivid quarry in its jaws, pleased to bring it to its master. In competition, the dogs gifted with naturally long toes from birth must be prepared for the trials because they can demonstrate their skills in these shows. If they become champions, they are in demand for stud purposes, which benefits the whole breed. In fact, dog shows have the precise task of indicating which dogs are closest to the breed standard, with the ultimate aim of every dog becoming an absolute champion, best of breed, best in trial. Several Drachtars have achieved this aim. The more consistent trials are similar to the dog's work and are developed using all the game that it might meet in its homeland. It is rare to see the Drachtar taking part in specialist shows with trials on woodcocks and snipes, because the breed has, above all, the peculiarity of being generic and adapted to everything. Therefore, it is impossible to measure the talent of a dog if it is not run on a variety of terrain where the encounters with game are diverse. Unfortunately, the Italian trials rarely foresee the retrieve, since the game is not killed. This is because they are held in the closed season or in places where hunting is prohibited. Missing this important moment, unthinkable in the country of origin, where the retrieve has a particular ritual that notably affects the qualification and classification of the dogs. The hunting trials are nearly always run singularly, but for classified dogs, there is also a short run in pairs. The dogs must be taught to work in pairs, and the Drachtar performs like the other continental breeds without too many problems once the initial moments of indecision have been overcome. Within the 10 to 15 minutes foreseen, it is generally not distracted or out of form. In fact, the breed was developed for a much more demanding task and long hours of hard work. Long ago, Germany had three short-haired pointers: the true German bloodhound, a very large dog, the Weimaraner, and the Württemberg, with a brown roan colour and tawny markings on the face and the limbs that at times reappear in the Kurzhaar. With the arrival in Europe of the English setters and pointers, the German breeders worried that their own strains would lose popularity at home, and they began to refine them with blood from the pointer and strict selection. The national hound was thus transformed into an agile aide, swift and elegant in form, with a robust but athletic body, maintaining the characteristic lines of the continental breeds. In the field, it was transformed from a slower trotter to a fast galloper. The Kurzhaar was fortunate after the First World War. In spite of the negative results of the conflict, the state became interested in the development of the breed, encouraging the importation of quality pointers in order to crossbreed and refine the old bloodhounds. The work of breeding was entrusted to qualified people and the gamekeepers on the government estates. The tenacity of the breeders and the far-sightedness and clarity of this desire to create a new gun dog brought the results that we can see today, an elegant dog with a strong personality that has won fans all over the world, spreading throughout France, Italy, Yugoslavia, Great Britain, and even the United States. Germany can claim the origins of the breed, but France and Italy have been responsible for improving it and raising it to the level that makes it sovereign of the continental breeds, in hunting and in work tests, where it graduates with flying colours. At shows, the Kurzhaar is always present with exceptional examples of distinction and conformity to the standard. As we said, the breed has always been appreciated in France and Italy, and breeders have not hesitated to import excellent examples, first from the country of origin and later from other countries in which the Kurzhaar has a long tradition. The Kurzhaar has undergone a continuous evolution, which seems to be continuing in the world of competition dogs. Belonging to group 7, the pointers, it is a dog of middle size. The height at the withers is between 58 cm to 64 cm for dogs and 56 cm to 62 cm for bitches. The overall form is mesomorph, with well-balanced square trunk, the height equal to the length. The head is lean with a clean and well-marked profile. The cephalic index is about 50, which is to say that the width of the skull is equal to the half of the length of the head. The forehead must be flat and the median line must be nearly non-existent. The upper longitudinal facial planes diverge. Parallelism is tolerated but not appreciated. The stop is slightly marked. The nose must be long and the nose is big with open nostrils that are very mobile. When seen in profile, it must be prominent. It is brown, but darker than the coat. The upper lips must remain close to the jaws. The lower profile of the face, drawn by the lips, is semicircular and joins the plicker of the lip commissure. The teeth form a scissor bite. The eyes are almond-shaped in a semilateral position, dark with a wide-open, decisive look, and never light in color. The ears are wide, pendant, and set high, above the eye line, and the front edge of the auricle reaches halfway down the zygomatic arch. The neck is quite long, like the head, strong, lean, and muscular without any ridges. Where it is joined to the skull, it makes a separation and flows gracefully to the trunk. The upper line is slightly arched, while that, lower, follows it in harmony. The length of the trunk is equal to the height at the withers, with a straight upper profile. The belly must be moderately retracted. The withers are well elevated in comparison with the trunk. The loins must be well joined to the line of the back, solid and very muscular. The croup is always wide, muscular, and nearly horizontal. The tail is attached rather high, strong at the root, and is docked to not more than a third of its length, so that it covers the genitals. The brisket must reach the elbows and is round compared with the pointer, but never flat or barrel-shaped. The forequarters must be perpendicular when seen from the front and in profile. The shoulders are muscular and loose in movement and sloping 45 degrees to the horizontal. The tops of the shoulder blades must not be too far apart. The arms are strong and muscular, and the forearm has a strong skeleton, not spongy and with an oval section. The feet have closed toes that are quite curved. They appear oval and the pads must be hard and dry. The perpendicular from the croup must reach the ground at the tip of the toes in the hindquarters when seen in profile. From the back, the dog must show good angulation. The thighs are powerful with evident muscling that shows thrust and a vigorous gait. The rear paws are similar to the forepaws, but slightly less oval. The skin is close-fitting and covered with thick, short, rather coarse hair. The shining and bright coat is always conspicuous, whether roan or self-coloured. The following colours are admitted: brown and black, self-colour or mixed to form roans. Pied markings are admitted, but not desirable. The pigment of the lips, the claws and the pads must be darker than the coat colour. Eliminating faults: accentuated underbite and overbite, monorchidism, anorchidism, and cryptorchidism, congenital aneurysm, fringed coat, totally depigmented nose and eyelids, china and wall eyes, crossed eyes, tawny grey or brindled coat, not limited to a rectangle, presence of dew claws. Height, 2 cm in excess of the standard or 2 cm below the minimum permitted. The original German standard established a height at the withers for dogs of 66 cm, which with the 2 cm tolerance gave rise to excess height that did not guarantee speed or resistance. The truly typical Kurzhaar performs well in dog shows because its gait in the ring shows elegance and power, with a pace of normal length even at the trot. A homogeneous group of Kurzhaars is a fine sight and will outdo other breeds considered more suitable for showing, a sign that the breed is both suitable for the strenuous work and maintains a high degree of typifying characteristics, which is a sign of rational breeding. This breed has no difficulty in breeding, and usually the bitches are good dams, mindful of their puppies up to weaning. Weaning takes place, as in nearly all the other medium-sized breeds, at about 60 days. The puppy already shows the features of a grown dog, with differences that only the experienced eye can note, but the essential attributes are already visible at 3 to 4 months. The Kurzhaar, as with other continental breeds, including the Espagnol Francais, is precocious and soon shows the inherited qualities. It is interested in hunting and pointing, and if it comes upon game, it doesn't behave in an excessively aggressive manner. Puppies of just 4 or 5 months can be seen casting methodically for game and stopping introduced quail. But these games based on the use of substances are bad both for this dog and other pointers. It is not unusual for the Kurzhaar to be useful at hunting even before it is a year old, because its instinct shows early when the dog is of good pedigree. It naturally picks up everything within reach as soon as it is weaned, and it is well to exploit this natural impulse and begin teaching the retrieve. Every day, the puppy should be thrown a small ball made of rabbit skin or soft pieces of wood with a quail wing attached, and in time the result will be a perfectly executed retrieve. In the country of origin, this moment of training has a complex ritual that ends when the dog retrieves the object or game, goes to sit before the master, and waits for him to put out his hand to take it. The training of the Kurzhaar should be based on immediate response to basic commands such as heel, down, sit. The typical strictness of the German school is not necessary, but the dog should understand and obey. The dog must come immediately if called. A juicy tidbit will be the most suitable reward, since the dog has a strong appetite from the very start. The Kurzhaar is a precocious breed, except in rare cases, but it reaches complete maturity and is fully trained for tests at around 15 to 16 months, as can be seen in continental contests, when many young Kurzhaars compete. The Kurzhaar is an admirable working dog which adapts to the terrain, blending and harmonizing the merits of the English breeds with those of the continental breeds, while maintaining a strong personality and individual appearance. It sets off decisively with an exuberant action and a continuous energetic but not impetuous gallop. Vigorous smooth thrust from the hindquarters is accompanied by slight lift from the forequarters. The stride is contained, the ears moving, the neck outstretched, the head held high and still. It has a masterly sense of smell, ready to pick up the slightest scent. The muzzle tends to the horizontal. The tail is carried slightly low with a continuous and lively wag. Its cast is diligent and wide in straight, close diagonals. The Kurzhaar, unlike the English breeds, and in particular the pointer, must have a mobile head and not hold its head and neck rigidly, because its method of scenting is different from that of the English setter. The Kurzhaar must pick up and analyze with care any odor at every propitious moment. The tail must not be carried stiffly like the pointer. The sideways movements denote a greater propensity for work done well, but not too quickly. When it mistakenly thinks it is near the game during the search, it gradually slows to a trot, ears erect, neck outstretched, turning towards the source of the odor with the legs slightly bent, tense and alert. Overcoming the uncertainty, it returns to the usual gait with a rapid burst. This is the classic check of continental dogs, which pass from the gallop to the trot without worrying about detail and throwing the nose out. When it picks up even a slight sign of game, it reacts immediately. It slows quickly from the gallop to the trot. Then after only a few steps, it stands on point. The head is held high, the muzzle horizontal, the ears retracted, the eyes bright and the neck outstretched. The body is flexed and the forelegs generally move forward and the hindquarters are bent. Frequently, one of the forelegs is lifted. When the Kurzhaar detects a more or less distant scent, it sets off in a direct line that may be compared to that of the English setter, gradually slowing down until it reaches the classic point, the tense, long neck pushing the head high toward the distant scent. It is a magical moment that characterizes the Kurzhaar and wonderfully spectacular for its classical observance of the breed standard and the way it was conceived. When it is certain of being near the game, it stops cautiously, lowering its body on its bent legs, sniffing frequently. Sometimes the stop is sudden, but it is always fluid. When the dog finds the game before it, it stops with the head just below the horizontal, pointing towards the prey. The dog remains tense in a complex position with the tail on the dorsal line. It is an attractive position, not too theatrical, because the Kurzhaar's brain is a shrewd controller, as can be seen in the eyes, which show perfect mastery of the situation. If the game tries to escape on the ground, the dog continues to hold its head high and in perfect harmony with its handler, it follows, keeping pace with the game and maintaining the correct distance. The tail moves horizontally and becomes immobile at every brief stop. It contracts and bends its limbs. The dog is impressive with a long neck that leaves the trunk in a line that tends to rise slightly. The tail, unlike the English breeds, does not remain rigid, but it moves horizontally and it only becomes immobile when the game is at a standstill and the Kurzhaar is also still. It must be said of the Kurzhaar that it has a decided congenital instinct for retrieval and for delivery. This breed's work is the result of great intelligence and a truly sincere love of its master. Snappy or aggressive subjects do not belong to this breed, which has a gentle, remissive, but not subservient character. The Kurzhaar is a true continental, with all the tenacity in carrying out its work so typical of its native breed. Kurzhaar has a reputation for being a useful gun dog and was once one of the most commonly used breeds. In fact, the Kurzhaar lies somewhere between the continental hunting breeds and the English setter and pointer. It has speed and quartering instinct midway between these two extremities, the first considered too slow and narrow, the second extremely fast and open. The Kurzhaar has always been considered one of the best gun dogs, although English setters and épagneuls français are now preferred. This is only a consequence of situations that have nothing to do with the intrinsic value of the breed. In hunting, the Kurzhaar proceeds at a fairly fast but not unbridled gallop, and according to the situation, it can also help in the detailed phases, above all on the long casts if the game is pheasant or quail, but also at times with woodcock. This is not expected from the work standard, but in everyday practice it is tolerated, provided that the work is brought to a conclusive and sure outcome. In fact, in most cases, the Kurzhaar is a truly skilled catcher and holds its position even if the game seems to be still for a long time. The traditional hunter prefers the Kurzhaar not to gallop wildly. It should gallop in the characteristic manner of gun dogs. The Kurzhaar has no problems in woodland, thick undergrowth or brambles, and keeps itself under control without any useless and unproductive rushing about. It is one of the best breeds for hunting pheasants, the main game nowadays. It searches stubbornly and tenaciously until it reaches a favorable conclusion. It can retrieve bulky game even when it is wounded and has run a long way. It is useful in open fields, knowing how to use its sense of smell, pointing from a distance, exploiting the wind to indicate snipe in bogs and marshes. The Kurzhaar does not show preference for any particular type of game, and it is useful and successful with quail, pheasant, grey partridge, woodcock and snipe. It is also used profitably with game in the high mountains like the Greek partridge, the black grouse and the white partridge. Like other German breeds, it likes the big deer and needs a firm hand to deter it from useless pursuits that tire it out needlessly. It is also useful with aquatic birds and is not afraid of plunging into the water to bring them back from deep ponds, lakes and rivers. In work tests, the Kurzhaar often finds itself in the remarkable position of first place. It performs better in the single classes than in pair classes, even though it easily gives up the ground to its companion. The gallop is the truly classical and admirable gait of this breed. All the subjects that take part in the tests show the characteristic movements with a vigorous thrust from the hindquarters, accompanied with the slight rearing of the forelegs. Above all, it is the outstretched neck and the head with its high position that gives the Kurzhaar its particular beauty. The lines and the slowing down with every weak scent are one of the better characteristics of the breed and so typical of the pointers. In the point, it is never jerky and nervous, but always ready. Only the tail beats sideways while the nose seems to want to approach the source of the smell. In tests, the dog must undergo considerable exertion that lasts less than a quarter of an hour, but if the dog is healthy and well built, it should have no problems in this respect. There are few breeders, even less than in the past, but those who have persisted are highly skilled and offer absolute guarantee for the future of the breed.
A proper diet is essential to your dog's correct and full development so as to be able to keep it in perfect shape and health. Some people believe that dogs can eat virtually anything and therefore give their dogs all kinds of food, often recycling the leftovers from their own meals. This is a serious mistake, since what may be digestible to us and a source of nourishing substances often cannot be digested by dogs or is unable to be metabolized. A final piece of advice. It sometimes happens that a dog loses its appetite and refuses food for 1 or even 2 days. This is a normal occurrence, and in these cases it is a good rule not to always leave a full bowl of food down for the dogs. Instead, the food should be removed after a short time. Present the bowl of food again at the following mealtime after having changed its contents. In the event of loss of appetite lasting for more than 2 days without the presence of side symptoms, or if it is accompanied from the outset by symptoms of general suffering or exhaustion, consult your vet immediately. It is very likely to be an ordinary ailment, but in this case it is not worth taking a risk. and it's better to seek reassurance from an expert. We will now begin with a brief description of a dog's digestive apparatus. As in all carnivores, the stomach is of large dimensions, whereas the intestine is relatively short. Initial digestion in the stomach takes from 3 to 8 hours, then the food passes into the intestine where the nourishing substances are assimilated, which are then transmitted to all the organs through the blood. The stomach's large capacity and the slow digestion process allow abundant meals to be eaten at fairly spaced out intervals. Naturally, to keep dogs in excellent health, it is necessary to provide them with all the elements that they require, that is, proteins, carbohydrates, fats, vitamins, and minerals. When dogs were carnivorous predators, these elements were assimilated by dogs through the animals that they hunted and which were generally herbivores. Afterwards, civilization has led it to feed differently, but it will always be necessary to provide dogs with the appropriate substances. Dogs produce energy from their diet, which is then used for the maintenance of vital functions and movement. The more active a dog is, the greater the energy intake it will require. Without going into detailed food studies that would require a specific treatise, we can simply say that dogs particularly require fats or lipids, both of animal and vegetable origin, and it is these which provide the necessary energy and which accumulate in the organism to provide possible energy reserves. The proteins that make up the large part of the animal's body are also essential. These are indispensable to the formation of all the tissues, especially muscles, and also constitute the basis of hormones and the blood. They therefore represent an irreplaceable element in a proper diet, even more so in puppies, which must build their bodies. Sources of protein are meat, cheese, eggs, and fish, which are well digested by dogs, and also soybean flour, peanuts, legumes, which are, however, digested with more difficulty. An excess of proteins is harmful and can lead to various kinds of disorders, depending on the conditions. Carbohydrates are not essential to a dog's diet. They are, however, very useful at the end of pregnancy. Starch, which is the most important carbohydrate present in the diet, is poorly digested by dogs and needs to undergo preliminary treatment such as cooking, flaking, etc. This is why if you use pasta or rice as a food for your canine friend, it needs to be boiled for a long time to eliminate a large part of the starch present. Fiber, which often accompanies carbohydrates, is especially useful in the diet of sedentary dogs, since it helps to prevent constipation, given the speed with which it passes through the alimentary tract. Vitamins are also necessary, even if in infinitesimal amounts. They are found in many vegetables and are synthesized by herbivorous animals. This is the reason why when a carnivore kills its prey, generally herbivorous, it immediately feeds on the intestines, where there are residues of partially digested vegetable matter. This also explains why, to your considerable annoyance, your dog often eats the excrement of herbivorous animals as soon as it gets the chance. A buildup of vitamins can be harmful, and therefore, if you use pre-prepared feed, you should carefully check the substances contained in the feed before adding supplements, and if in doubt, consult your vet. Minerals are essential to the diet and are supplied by foods. Deficiency in certain minerals such as calcium, iron, potassium, sodium, copper, and others can cause abnormal growth in puppies, also with serious consequences and general debility in adult dogs, or the onset of problems of varying degrees. There is excellent pre-packed feed on the market, both moist and dry types, that provide all the necessary elements for initial growth, and to then keep your dog in top shape. Even if you use pre-packed feed, you will, however, be able to give some fruit or other food which your dog will find tasty, taking care not to exaggerate and not to give harmful substances such as sweets, fried foods, rice dishes, fresh or soft doughy bread that are extremely harmful and which can also have very serious long-term consequences. Instead, if you want to prepare the food yourself, then follow the advice of the breeder who sold you the dog or your vet's advice. As a general rule, it is worth knowing that meat, ideally beef, is essential. If pork meat is given, it must be well cooked in order to avoid infections. Poultry meat and rabbit are also fine, provided that they are completely boneless. Giblets, although less rich in nourishing substances, are well liked. Fish is an excellent food and is best given cooked. It is particularly advisable for low-fat diets for dogs with digestive or skin problems. It is also an excellent means with which to make the diet less monotonous. Eggs are appetizing and supply many nourishing substances. They are particularly advisable for puppies and suckling females. Yolks can be consumed raw, whereas the albumen should always be cooked. Fats, such as lard and oil, are always readily accepted by dogs and are particularly useful during moments of work or physical effort. 1 or 2 teaspoonfuls of oil added to food are always beneficial. Dry bread is a good energy source, but it must be well dried. It is also useful for cleaning your dog's teeth and for keeping them in good condition. Pasta and rice are very useful, but as we have already said, they should be cooked very well to eliminate starch, which is not easily digested. Fruit and vegetables, even if not essential, can be given to dogs that appreciate them. However, the nutritional intake is very slight and is only worthy of note for the intake of roughage. Needless to say, the final element which is essential to nutrition is water. Fresh and plentiful, that must be available at all times. If in a bowl, it should be changed as often as possible, especially during hot spells. It is absolutely indispensable to dogs that eat dry and not moistened feed. The final aspect of the diet to take into consideration is the frequency of meals. From birth, puppies have their meals by following times that are spaced out by the instinct of the mother and the other siblings in the litter. The feeds are gradually reduced during weaning and are integrated with suitable foods that should be recommended by an experienced breeder or a vet. Between 1 and 3 months of age, weaned puppies should have 4 meals at regular intervals. From 4 to 7 or 8 months, the number of meals can be reduced to 3, further reduced to 2 meals at 8 to 18 months, and afterwards, if desired, down to just 1 meal a day, even if it is not harmful to continue with 2. On the contrary, this is recommended by certain individuals. The decision to have a dog is an important one to make, which must be thought over carefully without ignoring some useful basic information. The vaccination prophylaxis must always be carried out with utmost care to try and protect not only the puppies but also adult dogs from the most common illnesses. Generally speaking, a puppy leaves the breeder after having been vaccinated at around 40 to 45 days with a triad vaccine against canine distemper, infectious hepatitis, and parvovirus. A second quadrivalent vaccination, also including leptospirosis as well as the 3 ailments already mentioned, is generally carried out after 3 weeks. An additional vaccination can be carried out after a month, again quadrivalent, to be then replaced annually throughout the dog's lifespan. A dog can be vaccinated only if it is in perfect health and thus also free from endoparasites. Appropriate antihelminthic treatment must be carried out normally twice a year. Different types of ascarids exist, each of which specifically infests an animal species, man included, and there is practically no risk of zoonosis, that is, transmission of the infestation from dog to man. It is important that dogs are also kept free from ectoparasites, that is, those that live on dogs such as fleas and mites, both of which are hematophages. Moreover, fleas act as an intermediate host for a type of taenia. Numerous specific products exist to free dogs from these annoying parasites, but one must not forget to also carry out appropriate disinfesting operations in the areas where dogs live. The arrival of spring exacerbates the problems caused by undesired guests, the mites that arrive along with the initial spring warmth. A run in the meadows through woods, perhaps near groups of farmhouses and farms where there is livestock, can result in our canine friend returning home with mites. Not necessarily, since some factors may exist which make a dog more or less susceptible, also depending on its general state of health, that can influence whether or not a dog will pick up these acari. They represent a grave danger to dogs because they transmit pyroplasmosis, a serious infection carried by protozoa of the pyroplasma species that affects pets and also causes death if not discovered and treated in time. The symptoms in its acute form are represented by fever, also sthenic, asthenia, pallor of the apparent mucous membranes, and hyperchromia of the urine that can also become brown-black in color. In advanced cases, jaundice and a comatose state, which could possibly result in death. The mites suck blood for 2 or 3 weeks, and once having mated, the female then detaches itself from the animal and deposits the eggs a week later. The deposited larvae, recognizable by their reddish color, are minute, like tiny beads. They also look for a host on which to climb, sucking blood for several days. They then detach themselves and after a few days change into octopede nymphs of bluish color. They become adults towards August or September. With the arrival of autumn, the adults immediately upon hatching then lay dormant in cracks in the ground until the next spring. In general, the mites attach themselves to less thick skin, such as ears, armpits, groin, between the digits of the paws. Therefore, as a precautionary measure, we should always examine our canine friends for signs of any undesired guests after a walk in the open. Correct dog hygiene starts with coat care. For most breeds, but not all, it is advisable to brush the coat almost daily in order to remove the hairs that have reached the end of their life cycle. The coat of many breeds requires specialized grooming, which is to be carried out several times a year. One must not generalize about the fact that a shiny coat is a sign of good health, since in some breeds it should have a tendency to be dull. Dogs must not be washed too often so as not to damage the protective function of the sebaceous glands. The skin in normal conditions should always look clean without dandruff deposits or desquamations of any kind. Should cutaneous alterations appear, such as eczema, alopecic areas, i.e. hair loss and failure of hair regrowth, thickening or the appearance of abnormal pigmentation, consult your vet without delay. Cutaneous alterations due to mycosis or mange are spread by contagion, but only in the case of particularly debilitated animals and when one fails to observe the most basic hygienic rules. Claws must also be checked periodically. These are normally worn down in dogs that undergo normal physical activities, but it may be necessary to shorten them with the aid of a special tool. Oral hygiene should never be overlooked, and especially in miniature breeds, tartar removal is necessary from time to time because it can cause pyorrhea and bad breath. Certain bones are available on the market that, besides constituting a treat for our four-legged friend, act as a natural toothbrush. In puppies aged between 4 and 6 months, the deciduous dentition is gradually replaced by the permanent one. Regular inspections of the mouth are advisable during this period to check that everything is okay. The existence of cardiopulmonary filariasis, a serious disease caused by a nematode parasite, Dirofilaria imitis, or the blood and heart, has been known for several centuries, as has been known the important transmission mechanism of the disease by the mosquito for about a century. However, it is only in the last 20 years, due to the rapid diffusion of filariasis in dogs kept for company and work dogs, that research institutes, pharmaceutical companies and vets have paid increasing attention to the problem. It is therefore important that dog owners are also aware, even if in general terms, of the existence and phenomena of the parasitosis. The transmission of the disease occurs through the mosquito's sting, which takes up the filaria larvae by sucking blood from an infected subject to then inoculate them into another healthy dog. The high contagiousness of the parasitosis is therefore easily understandable, in addition to its seasonality, spring-summer. During a period of around 6 months, the larvae in the dog's blood grow into adult worms that are situated in the heart and pulmonary arteries. In turn, the adult filariae produce small larvae called microfilariae, which will live in the blood. The dogs most affected are obviously those that spend more or less long periods outside, hence gun dogs, work dogs, and those that sleep in the open. The damage induced by the presence of the filaria is of considerable seriousness for that which concerns the cardiocirculatory function and initially shown as a tendency for dogs to tire easily and the presence of a cough or respiratory dysfunction. The vet giving treatment at this stage will perform different clinical and laboratory tests that will confirm the presence of the parasites. On the contrary, the damage caused by chronic cardiopulmonary filariasis is extremely serious. The alteration of the cardiocirculatory function is often accompanied by liver and kidney lesions and a state of generalized hypersensitivity in the whole organism. The prevention programs that have only been practicable for a few years, thanks to the use of specific new drugs, are simple to carry out and do not involve toxicity risks for dogs. After having carried out a test to ensure the absence of a previous infestation, the oral administration of a medicine once a month for the duration of the entire hot season will give dogs effective protection, also if they are stung by an infected mosquito.